The 37-64, Elvis Presley, Boulevard. Hit it, Elvis. You got me.
Well, Keith, here we are in Huntsville, Alabama, and we're 49 years. You were here in 1975, and you were here in 1976. And luckily for us Elvis fans, you were here at a time when Elvis put on, and you've even said, probably five of the best shows that you had ever seen, and five of the best of his career, among five of the best of his career.
Yeah.
And some of these photographs were from those shows, and these are photographs that are in your book, and here in a little bit we'll talk a little bit about your book. But first I wanted to just say thank you to you and your wife and your brother for driving over from Georgia and coming over here and spending a couple days with us and touring the buildings that you all were in. You know, Michael and I weren't as fortunate to go to these buildings, and so that's why we rely on you guys to share your stories, and sure. It's been a real privilege to be along with you guys and to hear your stories and to talk to you. And I just wanted to say thank you for that. Thank you for being part of what we do at Elvis Back on Tour. So thank you so much.
I appreciate what you and Michael do too.
Well, I appreciate that.
Because there's nobody else that's really, there's a few out there that are doing similar things, but y'all seem to be more serious about it, not into it for the money. And so yeah, I appreciate it, and I look forward to maybe we can do this again sometime.
Absolutely. And we just wanted to say thank you again for what you have done for the Elvis world. And you know, I was telling a friend of mine the other day, and I'm going to go through this quilt story one more time. The people that follow us know what I'm talking about, and I think you and I have had this conversation. I've always looked at Elvis as like a big quilt, and to make up that quilt, it takes so many threads, and each thread to me is a person. So to make up what Elvis was, you have to have that thread that was James Burton. You have to have that thread that was Ronnie Tutt. You have to have that thread that was all those different people that made him, you know, helped make him what he was. I fully believe, this is my opinion, and I know you guys, all you guys in the Elvis world, you and George and people like that, you play down your importance a lot. And I'm going to get you to, before this interview is over with, I'm going to get you to brag on yourself a little bit, because I just don't think that you guys realize how important you were in the Elvis world. If we don't have these shots right here, if you weren't taking these shots, we can hear the music, but we're not going to see the sights. And comment on that a little bit. Tell us, do you understand and feel, and do you recognize how important that you were? And I don't think that's bragging if you say, but I just think that you guys were so important. I just wondered how you feel about that.
Well, yeah, now that I've gotten older and can reflect back on it, it's almost like another person took the pictures, actually. Right. That's the way I feel about it. I just look at them, and some of them are so good, and the quality and everything, and I'm like, did I really take that picture?
Right.
You know, I can't take pictures like that now. When I go to a concert, they don't look like that.
Right.
Of course, these are all 35 millimeter, and I like that better than the digital cameras and the phones and all that. But the lighting in Huntsville when we were here in 75
was great. Right?
Was perfect. I mean, most of the shots you see of Elvis, you lose his hair, because his hair was jet black, almost blue black,
right.
Superman black. And if they didn't have the overhead light, you lost his hair. But in Huntsville, with the lights, I mean, you can see his hair in every single shot.
Right.
I mean, this shot over here, when I was on the front row, he was kneeled down talking to the lady there. And I had a 35 millimeter camera, and I had a 135 fixed lens, and his face, head just filled up the whole lens. And I know I was probably shaking. And I just knew he was gonna look up at me and say, hey man, how close do you want, you know, how many are you gonna take? You know, that's enough. Or he never ever said anything like that. I mean, he was aware of my face, I'm sure, but he didn't know my name, or we shook hands two or three times on stage at hotels and things like that. And he was aware of me. The color and everything on the Huntsville shots, there's nothing to compare them with on all
right,
the other shots I've got.
You're right, because the other day I think Michael sent you some shots of our studio, how we have our studio set up. And I'm proud to say that between you and George Hill, you guys make up our whole studio picture-wise. And we're proud to say that, because that picture right there from the afternoon show in 75, that is, I think, behind Michael when we do our videos. That's the picture that's right behind Michael. And I think the day I got that from you, I told you, I said, you can literally count the individual hairs on his head. And that's just phenomenal photography.
Mm-hmm. You can actually see the brown coming out in it here. And,
right.
The silver and the sideburns. And this is when he's talking about the creeping crud.
Right.
That lady that's,
oh, okay.
He's telling her he got the creeping crud and now you got it and
right.
whatever. And then he says something like, she said she didn't care. Huntsville's always been, when people ask me, what's your favorite shots?
Right.
What was your favorite show or whatever? It's not 70, 71, 72. But Huntsville, he just seemed like when he got off that other tour, the spring tour before, he wore the two-piece suit,
right.
the jacket, and everybody, especially the women, they didn't like that. It was okay with me, but I wished he had just took the jacket off like he did in 72
right.
and have just the shirt on. But I don't know why he didn't do that. But this shot is me shaking his hand when he first walked out. So he came right out of this, the car was right on the other side of this iron gate right here.
Mm-hmm.
And when he walked straight towards me, I was sitting right on that aisle seat. And I just said, I gotta go for it. So I just stood up and I held my hand out like that. And he saw me and he walked straight to me. I mean, and when he's walking out, the crowd is just going nuts. The flash bulbs are going off and it's like, it's a surreal type thing. It's like you don't even know you're there
right.
until you go back and somebody got, like my brother took the footage, Bruce. Mm-hmm. If he hadn't have took that footage, I would have never known exactly the way I shook his hand or he came straight to me or whatever. But when the other people down the row saw me do it, it's like a domino effect. Cause there's
right.
like seven or eight of them that stood up and he shook every one of them's hand. And he loved that.
Yeah.
He loved the fan reaction.
And isn't it amazing? We talked about this last night at dinner. You and I've talked about this several times before last night. But the story, and we kind of reenacted it out here earlier, and we're later in the interview, we're going to get into what we did just a little while ago as far as music. But I tell the story about, it's amazing how in 1975, you were here, Bruce, your brother was here filming. The lady that would later become your wife was sitting a few seats down from you.
Yeah.
You did not know that, obviously.
Nope.
A good friend of yours, Benny Jacks, was in the building, sitting up in section, I think she said 202 or 203.
Yeah.
George Hill, who became one of your best buddies,
yep.
and as far as photography and just one of your best friends,
yep.
was sitting right over here, and,
yeah.
and none of y'all
no.
knew each other.
No.
And now you guys are some of the best friends.
Yeah.
So tell us a little yeah. bit about that.
Yeah, well, that's just really strange. Marsha was sitting, I think she said, I was in seat one on the aisle, and she was on, I think, seat seven. So there's, what, five or six seats in between. And when she went up to the stage, I didn't know who she was, and I knew she was up there and she gave him something and I took that shot. And then after years later, she'll say, well, why didn't you get, you know, include me in there? Well, the secret to that whole thing was when I look back, that shot that I took as soon as she went up there and gave him the button, that was the last picture on that 36 roll of film. So as soon as I took that picture, I had to put the camera in my lap and reload, roll that film out of there while she's up there. See, I didn't see it probably. I was sitting
wow.
there And I got to where I knew how to do it in the dark. So I was unrolling that and reaching in my pocket, getting the new roll. I had the new rolls in the right and the used ones in the left. And so I had to put that one in there and sit, you know, I was probably doing, looking at her and whatever, and then rolling the new one. By the time I got that ready to go, she was gone. So that's what happened and why I didn't get her. George got her pretty good, but that was, see, if you had the digital cameras then with the 35 right. millimeter digital, oh, you could have took 500
Amazing.
Pictures.
Well, we're going to talk about that too here in just a minute, but first I want to talk to you about the youth that's coming along today. I'll tie this all together. But the younger fans coming up today that goes to a concert, they whip out a phone, and like you just said, they can take, you know, 200 shots at a concert.
Yeah.
That when I think about what you did, and I'm kind of putting you up there quite a bit because I'm thinking when you did what you did, you came in here, I think you told me, with three rolls of 36, right?
I probably had three rolls, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. And explain to the younger fans that are out there that are following Elvis today, and there's a lot of them, and I'm sure you're amazed at that too, that here we are 50 years later and we still got guys like Michael, who's 22, coming on and going, I really like this guy.
Yeah.
I want to try to get across to them what a hard job that was for you to come in here with just three rolls of film, not knowing whether or not it was going to turn out, knowing that you would have to take it somewhere and have it developed.
So didn't actually see it until like a week later.
Exactly. Where today, you know, the young kids can look down at the thing and say, oh, it didn't turn out, they delete it. Well, you didn't have that. You didn't have that opportunity.
No.
And you used, if I believe, you used a Minolta. Isn't that what you told me you used?
I had a Minolta 101 first, and then 76, 77, I got another Minolta. It was like a 107 or something. Basically about the same, but a newer version.
Right.
And I still got both of those cameras, but they don't work. They're the shutters ripped out or whatever, you know. But I've kept them, and I've had people offer me, you know, a large sum of money for them, which I don't understand.
Right.
But I do still have them, and I think you had asked me to bring them, and I think I forgot to do that. I just thought of it just now.
Right.
And but yeah, it was tougher, and all the cameras then were metal. They wasn't rubber or fiberglass or whatever. And I had that zoom lens. It was a 90 to 230 zoom where you could zoom, you know, if you were sitting up there, you could zoom more, you know, closer in. But once you did that, you lost the light. These shots were shot probably at like 2.4 for the people that know what that means when the shutter is open. And then the zoom lens wouldn't open any lower than 4.5. So you lost like half of the light with the zoom lens. So I never used that zoom lens on any of these shots because I was so close I didn't need it. But that zoom lens and the camera probably weighed, I don't know how much, 7 or 8 pounds. And people ask me, how did I catch certain shots or, you know, how'd you do that? And I said, well, I watched the whole show basically through the lens. So whenever he would walk or turn around and wink or boom, I got him, you know, because if you're sitting there like this and then you try to reach it up and try to focus, you missed it.
So let me ask you this. With that in mind, I used to film my son's baseball games or take pictures with the, you know, with the zoom lens. And I felt like I very rarely could ever enjoy a baseball game because I was looking at it through the thing. So do you feel like you lost out a little bit on the concert?
A lot of people ask me that, and they would say, oh, if I had to do that, you know, I don't think I could ever have done that because I feel like I would have missed a lot of stuff because I was always looking through the lens. But I feel totally different than that. If I hadn't had the camera up, I'd feel lost if I was sitting like this and waiting for something to happen because you just don't have time to react that fast. It's just I knew I had him wherever he walked, whatever. I had it focused constantly, you know. And then when he did something I liked or a pose or whatever, I popped him. And you couldn't do that unless you actually watched the whole show through the lens.
Well, I can say honestly, and I think I speak for Michael and a whole bunch of fans out there, we tip our hat to you for that because that was a price that you paid to give us this stuff. And any way you look at it, you paid a price for us because you went on the road, you followed him on tour, and we'll talk about that a little bit in a minute, but you followed him on tour. You would see sometimes back-to-back shows. Sometimes you'd see, you know, several different cities lined up in a row. So we thank you for that, because that was something, I know you enjoyed doing it, but again, if you weren't doing it, we wouldn't have this stuff. And I want to touch real quick on, so that people can get to know you a lot better. I just want to go back just for a couple minutes and just talk about, born over in College Park, Georgia, right?
Basically, yeah, suburbs of Atlanta.
And so you were telling me the other night about your mom and dad, how you got into Elvis. You want to share a little bit about that with us, about the American Bandstand?
Yeah, I have to give my mother credit for getting me involved in rock and roll music and Elvis. I was probably 4, 5, 56, 57 years. She always watched American Bandstand. I think it came on at 1 or 2 o'clock every Saturday afternoon. And she probably didn't tell me to come in there and sit down and watch it or whatever, but I guess walking around, seeing it, finally, you know, I kind of said, well, this looks pretty good or whatever. And it was like a ritual, I guess, every Saturday afternoon after a couple of times, you know. And so I'd sit there and watch. And then Elvis was on there with Hound Dog. He wasn't on the show because he never was on Dick Clark American Bandstand. They couldn't get him. And so when Hound Dog came out, they just, you know, they had the dancers out there or whatever doing it. And Dick Clark would introduce the song, saying it was a new song by Elvis. It was number one or whatever. And whatever it was, it clicked or whatever. And I told my mother, I said, you've got to take me to the store or whatever. I just got a little phonograph flip top record player.
Right.
And so I was already, I had a few 45s, and I knew what they were. And I said, I want to get that song by that guy, you know, Hound Dog. So she said that they took me to Sears Roebuck. That was the only place around then.
Right.
In East Point, Georgia, still in Atlanta. So we got the Hound Dog 45, and it seemed like they had my record player on a kind of a high table in the hall. And I had to stand in a chair to reach it or whatever. And I played Hound Dog constantly, over and over and over. And my daddy said that before he died, he said, I hated that song because that's all you would play. And I told you one day, like, what's on the other side? You ever play the other side? And I'd say, no, or whatever. He'd say, well, flip it over, let's hear it. And it was Don't Be Cruel.
Yeah.
And he'd say, oh, I like that better. And I'd say, not me. So I'd flip it back over to Hound Dog again. But that's how I got started into music, basically. I didn't know who anybody was. I think I was listening to the Chipmunks and that kind of stuff in those days.
Right.
And then Elvis just took over.
Right.
And we saw every movie that came out, Love Me Tender all the way to That's the Way It Is. And they were all drive-ins until, I think, Clambake or whatever, 68. We went to an inside movie theater, and I was like, man, this is great. Because I was always having to look through their heads in the front seat of the car, and I was having to look like this or whatever, and he had these little speakers, you know. But all that stuff is for a purpose, I think, to mold you or whatever. And I wouldn't take anything for those days.
That's awesome. That's a great story.
Yeah.
Now, so then fast forward several years, November 71, you go to Tuscaloosa.
Yeah.
And you're telling me, because you included those pictures, and we're going to talk about your books real quick
here. There's a couple of them.
But yeah, you put included, and I love the way you worded that when you wrote the book. You said that you put them in there to show you the difference of, you know, how much better that you got.
Yeah.
And man, you look at those photos from Tuscaloosa, and he's about that big.
Yeah, he looks like a little black ant down there. But I'm amazed that there are a few people that will say, oh, I don't know why you think so little of those. We think those are great because it's part of history, you know. And it shows the audience and the whole stage or whatever. And, you know, I'm just so glad that you did include those, you know. Most people would have said, no, we don't. The publisher would have said, no, we don't want those in there. But, again, when I told the publisher that I wanted every picture that I took after 73, of course, but I still wanted one or two of those. And then the Macon, Georgia in 72, I was way back, and I had a little Brownie camera that my daddy let me use. But yeah, those are, when you look at them, it means a lot to me.
Right.
Because I remember that day, the first time that I saw Elvis actually in person.
I bet.
Was in the same room with him.
Right.
You know, that means a lot.
And then in that book, I love, because then you turn the page and you got a new camera and you're in Atlanta.
Yeah.
And those are some awesome shots. I got the Cape shot.
Yeah, the Cape shots.
And in our studio. And yeah. Tell us a little bit about that day, that when you've got your new gear and here he is and you're pretty close.
Yeah. The Atlanta shows in 73, the first couple of shows I didn't have really close seats. They were kind of on the side. So they're basically full stage. Mm-hmm. And those were taken with slide film. I never could get really a good transfer from the slide film to print. And so after that, I didn't take that many slides anymore. My daddy always said, take slides, because they're beautiful when you blow them up on the screen, you know, you had those little silver screens you'd put the slide film up on. And
right.
I said, no, they don't transfer to print that as well as film. So I didn't use the slides much anymore for that. The Atlanta shots, the last show he played in Atlanta were the Cape shots, the famous Cape shots now, mm-hmm. of course. My family went to the show. We didn't have tickets. There was me, my brother Bruce, my mother, my father, and a cousin that had never seen him. She was probably 22, something like that. So we were just going to go there basically and try to catch him come in the back, because that was the thrill to see him drive in or wait for him to come out and whatever. So we were standing around the front entrance. The show had already started. Intermission was, I think, about that time. And we were just going to stand there and listen to it through the door.
Mm.
We were already there. Why would you leave when Elvis Presley was right there in that building? So before he came out, this man came around with a suit and tie on.
Mm-hmm.
And he looked out of place, and he saw us over there, so he started coming over. I said, oh, he's going to make us move. He's going to make us get away. And I said, so he comes over there, and he says, y'all not going into the show? And we said, no, we don't have any tickets. And he said, well, I'm going to tell you something. He says, I've got three tickets. There was five of us. And he said, I've got three. Now, I'm going to give you those three, and y'all decide who goes in. And he just says, good luck. And so I shook his hand, I said, thanks. And so I'm sitting there, you know, I'm like, hey, I'm going in. I've got my camera, you know, and all this. And my daddy, he took the first step, and he stepped back and said, y'all go. I'll stay out here and wait for you. And I don't know how my brother got axed out. I don't know if my daddy said, you need to, you know, step and stay back with me and let our cousins, never seen him, and then your mother goes in.
That was a good man, right?
So we did, because we didn't have much time to think about it, because the 2001 was playing, I think, about that time. I said, let's go. You know, so we got in there and we started walking. And I said, I don't know where these tickets are. And we got to the thing. He said, oh, y'all are down on the floor. I went, oh, man, okay. It's probably, I was thinking, 50 rows back or something, you know. So we're going about halfway down the floor, and they kept saying, like this, go, you're up there. So we went, and it was on the 10th row center seat. Now, later we found out that the 10th row center seats was band members, security guards, or whatever. That was the Elvis row. And evidently there was three tickets left that nobody wanted, or mm-hmm. they couldn't give them away to somebody they knew. So then they just give them to the fans. So we sat down on the 10th row, and Elvis was already, you know, about to throw the guitar and everything. And if you look back, I don't have any shots of him from that show with the guitar, because he was already done with that. And I had one roll of slide film, one. because I didn't think I was going to get in. Wow. I was going to just watch him drive through. I had one roll of slides, so I had to pick my shots. So I knew he did the cape, and I said, I've got to save at least four or five shots for the end to get that. And I did. And they're probably one of the most famous shots out there, the cape shots.
They hang in our
a lot
studio.
Of people are really they're crazy for the cape shots.
Yeah. Well, let's touch on the book real quick. I don't want to give too much away because then they won't want to get them because then they'll say, well, you already talked about it. But you do a really nice job, on those books where you give the building, you announce the building, you announce the date, and then you do a real nice summary of each, set of photos that you do from each city.
Yeah.
And then you go through there and then you show all the photos. What I was really impressed about too is you use somebody, I don't know who made the book, but it is high quality. I mean, that's a solid book, and it's a beautiful picture book, and it's filled with pictures. Both volumes are filled with pictures just like this. You were telling me the other day that volume one, you're sold out. You don't have them, right?
Yeah, I sold out of those about a month or 6 weeks ago. And the only way you can get them now is off eBay or Amazon or whatever. But when a book sells out, it's no longer in print. The ones that have them, those are collector's items, and the value just goes up.
And I'm proud to say that we have both volumes, and it's just a beautiful book to set. Both of them are just beautiful books to sit there and look and then read the stories, because you give a lot of background information, a lot of insight, a lot of nice stories about things that happened while you were in the different cities. So I love the fact that, I think our good friend Paul Sweeney, Sweeney,
Paul, Canada,
that's the same company that made his book, The One Night in Toronto, right? Didn't it the same
company?
Yeah,
Eric Lawrenson from Norway.
Okay.
He does a really good job on the books and the color transfers, and he worked pretty. We worked on both those books for about 2 or 3 years. It's impossible to have done that back in the 70s overseas like that. You just had to write letters back and forth and whatever. But I could scan a photo from a negative or a slide and send it to him, and he could do whatever he did, and then he'd get back and I'd say, yeah, it looks great. You know, what do you want on the cover? What do you want on the back cover? We argued about certain things
at
certain times, and he would eventually say, well, it's your book, you know, do what you want. He wouldn't agree with a lot of things, but they came out basically the way I wanted them to come out, and I've had a lot of fans just love them. And
love them. We're two of them.
And the first book that I did before that, it came out, I think, around 2000. So it's been out 24 years.
Right.
But it's a thinner book. It's only 100-something pages. But that book now, on Amazon, people will send me stuff off of internet and say, can you believe what your book's going for? It was like $450 for this $40 book that I sold 24 years ago. And then these books, 10 years from now, they're gonna be up to that figure probably.
Well, you've still got copies of the second volume,
Volume
right?
two, yeah. I've got about 100, a little over 100 left of those. Those will probably be gone by the, I'd say probably next summer, next year.
We'll put out as we always do, we'll put out a link on this video that we're gonna do for Huntsville. We'll put a link in there. They can contact you. And you said you'll even autograph it for them, right?
Oh, sure. Yeah, I'll personally autograph it to them. I've always done that.
Okay.
I'll autograph enlargements, 8x10s, 16x20s, and I sign all of the big ones and date them, show they were from. And
we're doing this because Keith is a friend, and we love Keith to death and his wife, and we just appreciate his work, and a lot of this, a lot of this hangs in our studio, and we're very proud of that. And like Keith said, he'll be more than glad to ship any of these photos to you and sign them. And they're well worth. I'm sitting here looking at these right now from the afternoon show, and they're just so crystal clear. And if you need some photos in your home or in your office or in your den, this is an excellent place to start. I wanted to hit on a couple things before we finish up. About an hour or so ago, we brought you in, and we try to do this whenever we can, whenever we have a special guest, especially that's going back to a building where they haven't been in a long time. You haven't been in this building in a long, long time. And one of the last times that you were in this building, you took those pictures.
Yeah.
And we had you set roughly where you sat when you were here 49 years ago. And on that big screen up there,
yeah,
we put your pictures and some other pictures. And we played the concert, parts of the concert for you. Can you just discuss and explain to the fans what that felt like for you? Because that's, in essence, that's really, that's our keystone. That's what we shoot for, that is to bring life back to these buildings. And the staff here was so kind, because when you guys pulled up, we had Elvis on the marquee out there, and you came in and you listened to this show. Just tell us a little bit about what you felt like sitting there listening to what you heard 49 years ago, almost to the day.
Yeah. Well, it's very special, and just so grateful that this building is still here.
Right.
There's so many of them that are gone.
Right.
The Omni in Atlanta is gone. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of history and memories there, and Huntsville's just a special. It was a special weekend.
Right.
76 wasn't the same as 75, but to hear the music playing and just, you know, looking up at the stage up here, knowing that he was here in person, and when you hear the soundboards, you can hear the audience, and almost brings you right back to where you were before. Like I told you before, the one song that would move me the most was American Trilogy. The middle part of it where the horns come in, mm-hmm. or you know which part I'm talking about, it would make the hair on the back of my neck stand up. You know, you just almost have a cold sweat.
Right.
And people don't understand that.
I'm just glad that we captured your feelings out there, because we were able to be there with you when you were watching it, and we were watching you. And that meant the world to us. And as we wrap up this interview, I wanna say a few things, and then I got one final question for you. But like I told you the other night, we were talking on the phone, and I said, you know, and hopefully this will mean something to a whole lot of people out there that didn't get to see Elvis, because I was one of those people. So I'm living that life through you, talking to you, talking to your wife, talking to George Hill, talking to all those people. That's how we have to capture that, because we don't have the opportunity to ever see him again. So I have to listen to what you tell me.
Yeah.
And when I was a kid, I had all these Elvis picture books. I told you this story the other night, and I would sit there and look through them and look through them. And you hear people talk about, you know, I dreamed of faraway places when I was a kid. I wanted to go to this place and that place. And my faraway places was Columbus, Ohio, you know, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, and, you know, Huntsville, Alabama. It's because I was looking at that Elvis book, and in the caption it said photo taken in, you know, Huntsville, Alabama. And I never dreamed in my wildest dreams that I would ever get to go into these buildings, because I wanted to go where Elvis walked. I wanted to, you know, you go to Graceland because you want to walk where he walks. You want to see part of his life. We come to these buildings because we're doing it on the other side. We're doing it not in his personal life. We're doing it, we're exposing his working life. We're taking you into buildings where this is where he worked. This is why we come here. And when we come into these buildings, it really moves you. And it's why we do what we do. And I just wanted to say thank you, because when I was looking through those picture books, you were probably a lot of those pictures that I was looking at and didn't even know it. And now I've got the privilege of sitting here and interview you and talk to you and shake your hand and say thank you.
Yeah.
So I appreciate what you did.
Yeah, I appreciate that too. And at this time, if I can, I would like to thank all the fans in the world, Elvis world, all the fans that have bought my books, mm-hmm. bought my pictures. I mean, this is actually about my 50th anniversary mm-hmm. from when I first started selling pictures in 74. So I would just like to thank all the fans out there all over the world that have bought the pictures, the books. They come to Graceland, and this may be the last time I'll get this opportunity to thank them all, you know, because they're amazed when they come, and they get to actually meet me, which I'm just a fan too.
Right.
I'm no better than anybody else.
Right.
But when he died, I thought it was over. In 77, I was getting ready to go on that tour, of course, you know, where he was in Maine, and mm-hmm. I had tickets, I think, for New York, Connecticut, Hartford, maybe. And I was getting my camera stuff together in my bedroom when my aunt called, and my mother answered it, and she said, turn the TV on, Elvis has died.
Good evening. Elvis Presley died today. He was 42. Apparently, it was a heart attack. He was found at his home in Memphis, not breathing. His road manager tried to revive him. He failed. A hospital tried to revive him. It failed. His doctor pronounced him dead at 3:00 this afternoon.
And I said, no, it's not Elvis. It's Vernon. Because I just seen Vernon in June. When I went to Indianapolis and Cincinnati, I mm-hmm. saw the last two shows he did. But when I turned the TV on,
yep.
after about 10 minutes, I said, it's true.
Pandemonium has broken out here on Elvis Presley Boulevard in Memphis. Thousands of fans from all over the country are converging on Graceland, trying to get in to view the body of the 42-year-old king of rock and roll.
And in a sense, you probably that day felt like you lost a friend, right? Because you'd seen this guy.
Member of the family.
Times. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, we cannot thank you enough, and we consider you a great friend of ours, and that probably means more to me than anything, as far as that I can tell people that Keith Alverson is a good friend of mine and my sons, and we can't thank you enough for traveling over here and spending the weekend with us, getting this on film. Our goal was to create a time capsule for you so that it's locked in for the rest of your life. You can look at this at any time you want. And we brought you here because we knew where some of the best shots were taken were right here in this building. We couldn't think of a better building to bring you back to. Yep. And we pulled it off. And yep. we want to say thank you for that.
Yep. Appreciate it.
All right.
And I want to get a plug on my jacket over here.
All right.
This is a recreation of the 76 tour jacket that the bodyguard security wore on tour. Colonel Parker, you know, I have to give him credit for that. He's the one that I was told had the idea. He made these up.
Mm-hmm.
And he had all the security guys' names printed here, like mine, red. I think all they had on theirs was West.
Right.
They didn't have Red West, they just had West.
I've seen a couple good pictures of like Red West with that on.
Yeah, but when I used to see the pictures, they only wore them like one or two tours in 76 before Red and Sonny got fired. They didn't wear them anymore. But I always loved the back where it said the Elvis Presley Show. And I liked it much better than the red ones when they came out in 77. I really didn't like the red ones that much. But you never saw this. And the original jackets they're going for, could be, you know, $1,000, $2,000 bucks now. So when I went over to Denmark in October. Henrik Knudsen, I know. If you ever met Henrik, he has the Memphis Mansion over there where he's kind of created the Graceland, the outside of it. It looks beautiful, perfect. Right. And the inside, he has a restaurant, gift shop, three floors. Bottom floor, he has just amazing. He's got a collection downstairs. It's just, it's pretty close to Graceland.
That's amazing.
He's got all kinds of collectible things down there, and it takes you a while to go through it. And then the third, upper level is where he does his
interviews and things.
His meetings, his like when we went over there and spoke with Sam Thompson, Charlie Stone, and Judy Palmer. That's another lady photographer that I've known for years. And so he's got that upstairs. I mean, so if you ever get a chance to go to Memphis Mansion in Denmark, you've got to go because it's beautiful.
Great.
And so he had these for sale in his shop, and I saw it, and I said, "Where did you get these?" And he says, "I have them made, you know, here. You can't, we went and researched it, and it's the closest thing to the original. It's 95% exactly the same way, you know." And I said, "Man, I would." He says, "I'll give you one. I'll give, you know." So we auctioned them off for a radio station there that plays just Elvis music to help pay for their cost.
Right.
And we walked around, and Sam, he auctioned his off, Charlie Stone, I did mine. And, so when I got home, I told Henrik, I said, let's let me be the U.S. distributor, and you be in Europe or wherever, and if people want them in the States, I'll send them to you, and if all the ones in the United States, I'll sell them. So they're not cheap, but it costs a lot to have them made and have them shipped overseas or whatever. And I sold them in January, and a lot of people up there loved them then. I'm going to have them in August for Elvis Week. So if anybody's interested, let me know the size that they have, and I'll bring them to Memphis and have them ready for you.
We'll put a plug, just like in the book. We'll put a link in there that they can go to. What's the price on them, just so everybody knows?
They're $145.
Okay.
And then if I have to ship them to them, it's like another $9 or something like that.
All right.
But they seem to be catching on pretty good, I appreciate it.
Be sure to check out our other video where you're going to hear from everyone else that joined us on our tour of the Von Braun Center. Thank you for watching. We hope you enjoyed. Please be sure to comment, like, and subscribe, as well as follow us on all of our social media accounts using the link in the description below.